They say the wealth of a nation may be measured by a king's coat. For each button, make a tally. For each seamless fabric, make a mark. Count the jewels, the hides, the luxurious feathers. Count it all and convert the tabulations to coin. There, they say, you'll find the wealth of nations. They are fools. I measure wealth by observing the mouth. For each time the king says simple or speaks of virtue, know there is a body hidden in a hole. When a king demands rents for the good of the people, know you will find a mass grave. When the king rails against corruption, watch the coins slip into their hands. The wealth of a nation is not found in the banker's ledger. The wealth of a nation is measured in bodies, bodies of men and women willing to fight and die in the name of tradition. From high up on that hill, she watches, proclaims, and commands. Boots, blades, and blood respond. That is wealth. South of us, a quiet king counts stacks of coin. His coat magnificent, his walls high, his authority lacking. For the low people, failure is forgivable. They lack the thick essence of nobility, the weight of tradition. The cost of failure matches their non-existent office. For a king, failure carries a fatal price. For an emperor, well, let's start small, shall we? Welcome to the Crooked Thimble, where like minds meet. Today, we continue our adventures in Iron Immortals, the shared setting between this tabletop game, the video game in development at the Crooked Thimble, and my latest novel, 7 Days a Servant. If you've not given it a look, 7 Days a Servant by Trick Dempsey is in its final month of fundraising, and we need your help. Head over to Inkshares, order the book, and bring the stories of Iron Immortals to the world. This game is being conducted using a hacked version of the Dungeon World system by Sage LaTorre and Adam Coble. Our heroes have an objective, the rescue of the Greenbark Gang, but they lack a plan, and allies, and supplies. If the Greenbark Gang is to come out alive, our heroes will need help. But help does not come cheap in Harris Reka, and someone is always listening. Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Crooked Thimble Plays Iron Immortals. Today we have with us three players playing Kyle Wellsmith. We have Hannah Garbaz. Hannah, can you tell us about your relationships with the other players, characters?
Kaya fears the consequences of Reed's decisions and needs to mitigate them. She feels that Isolde is learning from the Verdwood and wants to know what Isolde has learned. She has also faced death with Isolde, but Isolde learned something that Kaya did not.
We also have Brianna Dempsey as Impediment Reed. Impediment, can you tell us about your relationship to the other characters?
Impediment Reed thinks that Isolde's ways are strange and powerful. Do not anger her. Also, that Isolde may look all books, but she just might know what is good in life. She also thinks that Kaya knows restraint, and that I could probably stand to learn some.
And finally, we have Bob Poteet playing Professor Isolde Heisenberg. Professor, can you tell us about your relationship with the other characters?
Yes. From Isolde's perspective, Reed loves her family. I will see them reunited again. And Kaya will have an important role in the events to come. I have foreseen it.
Speaking of, when last we left our heroes, you were about to launch into some sort of scouting maneuver over Harris Reka. I would like everyone to direct your attention to Roll 20 if you can.
Oh.
Okay. We have all sorts of goals and things that we perhaps should not be seeing.
No, those I put those up there for a reason.
Oh my.
So you will see, beneath you are the goals that are totally negotiable, but this is my first pass at them, for what it is you are intending to do when freeing the Greenbark Gang, which all of you have now agreed to do. You have essentially 4 objectives. When you decide where and when to free the gang, mark experience. When you free the gang, mark experience. When you evade any pursuit, mark experience. And when you recover for the first time after the escape, mark experience. Now, that might sound lovely, but this game I'm borrowing heavily from something called The Sprawl, which is another Apocalypse World game. Dungeon World is a child of Apocalypse World. This breakout is going to be broken into two sections, preparation and execution. During the preparation clock, which you can see up there, is currently empty. All of these white lines over here that say 1800 and so forth.
Oh, those are the clocks.
Those
That's
are clocks.
What you went with.
I went That's with
good.
Clocks.
That's good.
Sometimes you will take moves that say that you draw attention or something bad happens sort of ambiguously. Sometimes when this happens, I will choose to increment a clock.
Hmm.
The preparation clock is how aware and concerned the organization that you are preparing against is with your current operation. So if that clock rises too high, there will be additional guards, it will be harder to defend against, or quite possibly they will move the execution if it fills all the way up. That would be bad.
Yes.
Separate from that, there are two factions which you've gotten the attention of. Scarlet, you are aware, knows that you're in town and is organizing this to get your attention. And beneath that, there is actually a separate faction which you got the attention of last time, and I've decided to make visible the fact that they're aware of you, but I'm not telling you who they are yet.
Lovely.
Yeah, That's it's exciting. All great. It's good times.
Somehow I feel like we just landed right in the middle of a noir when we thought we were in a foresty adventure game.
Yeah. We need a soundtrack.
So amongst your major moves, your moves that I've given you, your new special moves, probably the most important one to come to immediately is when we last left our heroes. It was night, the evening before the execution of the Greenbark gang, and you are outside the walls of Scarlet's menagerie, there with Shimshackle, who's just revealed that, literally, Brother Venamo is a bloodsucker. And you are planning some sort of scouting expedition to attempt to locate the gang, or to whatever other purposes that you have. Lead an undertaking is the kind of move that I would want to use for that, because rather than role-playing you guys through all of the weird steps of marking every possible part of this endeavor, I would rather hear what you guys might have planned, think of the role that each of you have, and then have somebody roll to see essentially when does the complication occur that makes this an interesting scouting expedition.
Hmm.
Okay.
I'm gratified that these adventure moves are int and charisma based.
We're all gratified that Isild has charisma.
Yes.
And int.
And it.
You have your own special create concoction move, which is almost exclusively for you. Good job.
Thanks. Because we're low on, or at least I'm low on, healing potions.
I think you're the only one who can get them.
So, I'm trying to remember what we were thinking. We had just gotten the bomb of, they're bloodsuckers. That's interesting and terrifying.
So you all have gathered here because you each had your individual rendezvous with various contacts throughout town. And you came here to have a final conversation with Shimshackle before kind of deciding on whether you're sleeping for the night or you're scouting the menagerie, because you all decided that you wanted to see what it was that Baron Nyland was talking about.
Yeah, I think we wanted to try to scout.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think that would be the first lead and undertaking thing that we would do, would be to scout.
And the Baron was saying something about the house that backs up to the ditch. That might be a decent way in.
Yeah, I would definitely want to investigate where she was suggesting.
Yeah, there are definitely guards at that front gate. Now, mind you, that front gate to on the southwest side of the menagerie is like a vomitorium. It's not even a gate. It doesn't have a big barrier that can slide across it. They have wagons, which they can put up, you know, spike barriers using, but those aren't even those are pulled closed, but they're only pulled closed like a picket line. It's not designed to stop people from going in. It's designed to make it look obviously like you're not supposed to go in there.
Right. So our primary goal is free the Greenbark gang.
Yes.
There's secondary objectives we may want to consider. One being not being detected while we do this. Pinning it on Brother Venamo, because he has a publicly known vested interest in seeing the Greenbark gang survive. And one other stretch goal that I'm kind of interested in is finding out what this redstone nonsense is all about.
Let me put out there that on this very evening, if you wanted to do the stealthy approach and try to break them out, you could, and I am prepared to run that. Your chances of succeeding without more information and more gear is very, very low. The fatality of that endeavor would be very high.
Right. We don't know where the Greenbark gang is right now. We have some estimation that they've been imprisoned in the menagerie itself. Am I remembering that correctly?
That is correct. I think so. Previously, Shimshackles told you that previously they were normally held in sort of a cage overlooking the sort of battle arena proving grounds in the center of the menagerie. However, that cage is gone. And there's that low moaning of the forest coming from not only the walls of this fortress itself, but also from within the menagerie, implying that they're somewhere deep within.
Yeah. Well, I think that our first undertaking should be to scout.
I'm up for this. How do we want to do that?
Well, I would point out that Baron Nyland's fortress kind of overlooks the menagerie.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps approaching from... Am I correct in thinking that kind of haystack looking area is the house?
That is the manor house. It backs up to the ditch and it is accessible from outside the wall.
Yes. So I would think that probably a way to do this would be to approach from the Baron's fortress area so that we could have an escape. Like, you know, have ropes or something set up so that we could get back up out that way, which is an unlikely place to do. Whereas if we needed to escape rapidly along the wall, we might be kind of screwed because it's just open space there.
I agree, although it might be better to go down into the ditch than try and scale the Baron's Mott. How tall is that Mott?
Yeah, how tall is that Mott?
That Mott is 75, almost 100 feet tall.
Yeah, it's, no.
It's big. That is a big man-made hill.
All right, I had no idea it was that tall.
There's no scale on this map, so that's understandable.
Yeah, it's true. You guys have been like 20, 30 feet tall, which would have been much more manageable.
Yeah, it's big. You would have to get rope from a vendor to have enough rope to build a little rappelling rope to go up and down.
But going down into the pit.
The pit is not flooded. It is a cesspit, though.
Ooh, that's not going to be pleasant.
No, so that's an emergency exit, but not our preferred option.
Yeah, you do get cholera as an effect of going into it.
Cholera.
Gross.
As long as we don't have to cross any rivers, we're okay.
So we may need allies or gear.
Yes.
In order to pull this off.
If you want to breach the interior and find them outright, yeah, you're gonna need allies and help. If you're just aiming to find out more, that would be what lead an undertaking is kind of for, is you would say, Kaya is going to get on top of the hill and look down and psychically communicate with Isolde and Reed, who are gonna be on the ground looking for stuff.
Yeah.
Like, that's the level of information that we need in order to make that roll.
Okay, so I think that's actually not a bad plan you've suggested there, is for Kaya to be looking down. It kind of jives with her, like, wanting to go back to the manor anyway and retrieve Angus, who could be useful in his scouting function. And
yeah. You're the ranger here. Do some surveillance.
Yes, and
start ranging.
There's also the surveillance thing, and the fact that she can in fact communicate with this old over.
So while you're being the sniper,
yes,
high ground scout. What are Professor Izzold and Reed going to be up to?
Well, before I realized it was a cesspit, peeking in through the ditch sounded like a better idea. Now it still sounds like maybe an okay idea, just a sucky okay idea.
I would note that the manor that she has there, that roof...
Does it not back up to the ditch?
It does back up to the ditch, because of course she has a latrine, and that's why it's backed up to the ditch. But it is two stories tall. So if you were to approach it from the ground level, you'd have access to the ground floor of that manor house from the back window without getting into the ditch, because it doesn't... One side of that wall extends over the ditch, and the other side does not.
Ah.
Hmm.
Now, you might be breaking a window. They do actually have glass here.
That's... impressive.
Yeah. So far, the only places the barracks doesn't, the manor house, the reliquary, and the Scarlet's Manor all have glass.
I think I would rather risk walking through shit than breaking glass and letting the inhabitants of the house know that I'm there.
Fair. Well,
but, I mean, how are you going to observe anything from down there anyway?
I'm like 7 feet tall.
Without breaking glass. I mean, the point of the breaking glass was not so much where you were standing as how you were going to look in.
I didn't think I was looking in the house specifically. I mean...
Oh, okay. I thought you
were. Like, there's a whole lot of ground to look in before we go into the house.
Okay.
So
maybe. Like, I don't know. Like, if we think it's really important to get in that house...
Well, it was just suggested to us by Baron Nyland that something about the back way and some sort of gate. So...
Professor, do you have anything in this initial scouting expedition that you... Is a goal you'd like to accomplish or a location on the map you'd like to become aware of?
Well, I'd like to... go about and get a sense of where all the entrances and exits are and how many people I can see are guarding them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Casing the joint.
So you'd like to case the joint. And you guys are thinking of casing the joint by coming up possibly through the ditch or around the ditch, but around the backside of the manor house, and then kind of casing the joint from there.
Mm-hmm.
Then that sounds like a plan. We know our roles there. We've got a point man / woman, which is Kyle Wellsmythe, and we've got two people on foot. Impediment, who is very good at escaping, and Izzold, who will need help.
Okay.
Yeah.
If that's the case, would the most analytical of you like to lead this undertaking?
Sure. Izzold is happy to... make a plan. Anyone want to help me?
Certainly. I would love to help you.
So here's the... Yeah, I guess you're all participating. So you do... By simply performing your roles, you're doing the necessary things for aid. So could I get an aid from both Reed and from Kaya?
Is aid just a... It's plus bond, right?
It's plus the number of bonds you have with Professor Izzle.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Where is my typey thing?
Professor Izzle has fucking nailed it, as a side note.
Yeah, I rolled a 10 on the dice.
That's awesome.
Plus 2 from intelligence, it's 12, and then pluses from all my friends.
Okay. So, Kaya, you are overlooking them as they sneak around the backside of the manor, And there are a bunch of support posts that keep the manor from just sliding into the ditch that you're able to parkour bullshit across and help Isolde across Reed.
Awesome.
And so both you and Isolde are inside of the menagerie now, and you see that they're like, it looked like there were just two guards patrolling that front gate, just walking back and forth along the picket line. But as it turns out, each of them actually has two waiting in the wings, gambling to either side. So the full total at that front side is six guards who wear these red sashes to indicate that they are Scarlet's men. Amongst that, you also see that there are two men. One is a guard who is holding up a lantern, and the other one looks like they're just a servant or a janitor of some kind, and they are picking about at the base of this massive combat arena that is sunk into the ground. So that's that pit that you're seeing inside the center of the menagerie mm-hmm. is like a 10-foot drop. They have a ladder leaning against the edge of it. And to the northwest side, you see three massive iron and wood doors that lead back into some unknown caverns deeper within the underneath the menagerie, essentially. And above those gates go into the ground. Above those on a platform are actually rows and rows of like risered chairs. So where you're seeing those other poles marked on the map, that's like an audience is meant to look through there.
Oh.
And you see that counting the number of seats that would belong there, that could easily be the entire contingent of soldiers. That could be everyone in town, all packed shoulder to shoulder, sitting on these seats.
Wow.
At this point, you're faced with kind of an opportunity. The guard in the middle is paying attention to and just kind of joking with the poor sap who appears to be plunging little holes that are in the ground in the center of, or just kind of around the arena. These little, golf hole sized holes in the ground. Maybe a little smaller than that. You are next to the manor house, and there are no lights on inside. You don't even see candlelight inside of it. And you have the opportunity, Reed and Isolde, to either try to get a closer look at the menagerie and its gated areas, or to take a look at the simple wooden door that leads into the manor house, or any of its windows.
Oh, shit.
What do you do?
Well,
those both sound like kind of risky opportunities, Reed.
But they also sound awesome.
You still don't know where the gang is.
I still don't know where the gang is.
It's worth the risk. Check in the menagerie.
I'm gonna listen at the door and see if it's locked.
The door is not locked, and you do hear. You're listening at the door. Give me a discern realities, actually.
Oh yeah, hey, right. We have moves for this stuff.
You have a move for that, and you decided to do it.
Oh.
Impediment Reed rolls a 5 on Wiz.
I'm maybe a little stressed right now and not really like heart racing and things aren't thinking clearly.
Okay. So you reach over to the door, and the door is actually like a
5 is just an outright fail, right?
That's an outright fail. Mark XP.
I'm marking that XP.
So you like reach over to the door and you test it because your first question was, is it locked? And you just push down on the handle, and there's like a pressure differential, and the door just flies open into the interior of the room.
Oh, shit.
And claps against the wall in there. What do you do? And by the way, Isolde, what do you do?
Isolde hides.
Where do you hide? Like, there's a building here that you can go inside of, or you could just lay down. What do you do?
Hit the deck.
Okay. Isolde, you fling yourself onto the ground. Kaya.
Yes.
Looking down, you can see that the janitor or whatever they are, the servant who's just cleaning up, they don't seem to give any mind to weird noises in the night. However, the guard jumps at it. and holds up their lantern and is starting to walk in the direction of the manor house.
Okay,
now, they've got a ladder between them and the manor house because they're down in that pit, but they are on their way.
All right, so I will tell Isolde, there's a guard on his way towards you. He just the one below.
Reed, you didn't hear any of that, but you can tell that the light inside of the pit is moving. What do you do?
If I don't see or hear anyone inside the building, I'm going in there, dragging Isolde behind me and closing the door as quietly as I can.
That sounds to me like a defy danger. That's quick thinking. And so that would be a defy danger int.
Oh, shit.
Because it isn't about doing it dexterously, it's about doing it quick enough to not be seen.
It's about doing it smart, which, oh, well, this could be hilarious.
I'll help.
Isolde, how are you helping?
By jumping up and saying they're onto us, and whispering they're onto us, and helping to rush inside.
Okay. Please roll your aid.
Did you say this was a defy danger?
Yes, you will be doing a defy danger.
Is it caused by movement?
I guess in theory, I will admit that this is caused by movement.
Okay, I get a plus one.
And you have an additional plus one, and quite correctly, Professor Isolde has succeeded in their role, getting a 9.
Plus,
thus,
plus one.
You have an additional plus one.
I actually rolled well this time.
Indeed!
I wanted to get you guys caught by a guard. Aw. Okay, so you slip into the house.
I can't and roll you... well to impress Barker, but I can roll well now. Ugh.
And you close the door behind you. You're inside of a... It's still a relatively modestly appointed manor house. There's still wood furniture. There's a dining room on this floor. It looks like there are stairs that lead up to the second floor. But also, there are stairs next to within an open cupboard that go down.
Oh.
It looks like beneath their stairwell, they have what would have looked like it should have been maybe some sort of linen closet or something. You don't know what these upper class people have. But it's open instead of being closed. And that must have been, you can feel wind coming from it. And it's got a stairwell going down.
Are there lights?
Wooden spiral staircase. And somewhere faintly underneath, but at a great distance, there is a light.
Oh, shit.
Or it could be, like, the tiniest candle, right at the base of it. You don't know.
Yeah.
I think
Kaya.
At Kaya, we're inside.
What?
Kaya, your friends are inside.
I know.
That guard has come to the ladder, and he's just sort of raised his lantern and is looking around.
The guard isn't going up the ladder yet. I'll let you know if he changes. What do you see?
I'll describe the light downstairs.
Oh.
The tiniest candle.
Isolde and Reed, what do you do?
I mean, this would be a pretty good time to see if she's maybe a writing type, like Isolde and Kaya, and maybe has written in crayon notes in her diary about how angry she is and what she plans to do tomorrow.
So you're gonna rifle around on the top floor for like
clues,
wicked plans,
clues.
Absolutely, discern realities. Yeah, discern realities while looking for clues.
Oh God,
bro, Raggy.
Oh one, my god.
One possible
oh
solution
god.
To this entire endeavor may be to gain leverage over the Scarlet Gang and blackmail them into releasing the green barks.
That is entirely possible unless Impediment Reed rolls. What did you roll, Impediment Reed?
Nothing. I rolled a 4.
Impediment Reed!
Okay,
but,
mark
like,
XP.
Isolde is also probably doing a thing. What's Isolde doing? Maybe she won't fail at life.
An aid won't help you at
That's
this?
That's not
and
what
you
I'm saying. I'm saying she should do her own thing.
Oh, she will, I'm sure, but you've done this thing, and we're going to
oh,
see the
God.
Consequences now.
Oh, God.
Okay, so you've got this, like, bright idea of, hey, I'm going to find a book. Books are trouble. And you see a desk, and like the her little dining room, this is still a pretty compact place compared to the manor house. Like the manor house upstairs that the Baron has is meant for servants, but this is a place where like somebody who does some of their own business like lives. So there's a hearth that's meant to have a fire here in the dining room. The dining room has, you know, a little table with four seats, and you see a desk, and you're like, oh man, a desk, that's where people keep things, and there's little books on it, and you're going through the books, and that allows you to see through, like, the far side window. It's like you've walked to the opposite side of the house, and now you're looking at, like, the opposite side from where you entered from, and into more of that sort of menagerie area, uh-huh. And you see that there is another guard who was patrolling the wall, and they see movement inside. But you're bright enough that you get your head out of the way.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't be sure they saw you, but you can be pretty sure they saw you.
Well, shit.
Izzold. Reed is rifling through some books rather clumsily on a desk. Because it's dark in here.
Yeah.
Let's say that. What are you doing?
I'm whispering at Reed. I don't think we should stay here. We should look inside the menagerie. And that's when I notice the opposite window. And I say, oh no, were we spotted?
Reed, you've just been spotted. What do you do?
To Isolde's thing, I nod emphatically. And, I have no idea. I sit down at the desk? I don't know. What you would I do if I were the person who actually lived in this house?
I like everything that just got discussed. Let me just real quick. I have to do something on the map real quick.
Oh, we're so fucked.
You shouldn't be super concerned about this. Everything is perfectly fine. Just let me move this.
What is that? A new clock?
Over here.
Oh.
And just fill this up.
Yeah.
Someone has noticed your presence here in the house.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Yeah. So your preparation clock is advanced. You're welcome.
Okay. How do we get out?
So, Kaya.
Yes.
The first guard has come to the top of the ladder and is just standing up there at ground level, looking around. And you can see that they're talking to someone else who is, from your vantage point, they're behind the house. They're kind of past the house and they're talking to someone there. And so you're seeing one man talk to a shadow of a house. But that's definitely two guards comparing notes.
You guys, I think they know you're there. Don't go out the way you came, because he's looking right at the door.
Yeah, we've been spotted by a guard at the far side. Is there any other escape route you can see?
I don't.
Would you like to...
Yes.
To do your thing? Do your wisdom thing?
I will discern the realities.
Did you bring your cat with you on this endeavor?
Yeah, that's part of why I went up to the manor.
Where's the head?
The head stayed put.
Sure did.
Oh.
It follows, mad-eyed you?
It follows Isolde, not Kaya.
That's correct. The terrible disembodied head.
His name is Herman.
Totally just stared at you. Yes, Herman just stared at you as you came into the room, and then followed you, like, just with the head out, but didn't, like, move, it just rotated.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. That was spooky. But I'm glad I went and got Angus. And Angus thought that the head is spooky, too. That's why he came with me, because he doesn't like the head. Head is spooky.
That's a good plan.
And so, I am going to discern realities with the aid of my cunning cat. Here we go.
Yeah, because you're scouting.
Because we're scouting.
That's good.
That's good.
That'll do.
That'll do.
You get three questions.
I get three lovely questions. And let's see, which ones do I want? What is about to happen?
What's about to happen is they're about to make a coordinated entrance through the front door.
Okay.
They're not raising an alarm. They are going in through the front door.
Yep. What here is useful or valuable to me?
So, how to phrase this? They're using oil or kerosene lanterns. If you wanted to ruin their day with a cold shot, you really could ruin the fuck out of their day.
Oh, okay. That would be interesting.
And not necessarily being detected.
Yes.
Because they wouldn't know that an arrow had come from God.
Indeed. Especially if I used a stone.
That's true. At this distance, you're out of stone range. You'd be using an arrow.
Okay.
Yeah.
And finally, what here is not what it appears to be?
They told you that there was a light down there. You think you see the other end of it. There is a light coming from inside that first menagerie container.
Oh. Okay. So, I will relay the information that they are about to make a controlled entry from the door, and I think that perhaps that light is coming from the menagerie. And then I'm going to try that called shot, because why have a thing called shot unless you can do it?
Yeah, do your nasty ranger thing.
I will do my nasty ranger thing and call the shot on the arms. Okay, I'm just going to roll plus that. Okay, and it.
And your intention is actually to, is it to hit the lamp or is it actually to hit the dude in the arm?
Lamp. I would much rather hit the lamp, because that would give me much less chance of detection, I feel.
Yes, and so you won't be rolling damage is mostly what I'm saying.
Correct.
We're modifying the move a bit.
Ah, I see.
So we have a decision to make, impediment.
Hmm?
There are two guards out there that are going to come through the front, try and come through the front door. Kaya's going to try and distract them. We can either try leaving another route on this floor, I'm assuming if there is, if we can find one, or we can go downstairs and investigate that light. What do you feel like?
The only route that I could imagine there being might be a latrine route, but I don't know how big there. I don't know.
You
if
did
fit,
pass
and I don't
under.
Think want to.
You did pass under a back window that goes over.
That's so much better.
Yeah, so it is totally the window from the latrine.
Okay.
Like, from that room. But nonetheless, it did go over the cesspit. Hannah, Kaya, what was your roll?
It was a 10.
Okay, so your arrow zips down from the mott, down from right beside the bailey, down and into the lantern that the guard is holding. It shatters and he's left still holding the handle when the oil splashes down onto the ground and then the wick drops into it.
Lovely.
And it lights up. And he's not, it's on his leg. He tumbles backwards trying to put out the fire on his leg. The other guard sets his lantern down. You can now see that he was lighting one. So there are two lanterns, only one is lit, and that one that's lit is on fire like everywhere. And, they're just desperately trying to put out these flames. You hear shouts from the guards by the gate. Fire.
Okay, guys, I have provided you with a distraction. I suggest Izzled you go
and
investigate
Reed.
The menagerie.
There's definitely a lot of fire outside and screaming.
All right.
What do you do?
I say we use that distraction and get to the menagerie.
Is there a way out that way? Okay. I'm following my brains. My brains say to go, I'll go.
All right, so you guys go down the stairwell, and you hear, you find yourself in what looks like an underground stable. It's the strangest thing. While I zip over to a map so that I can describe this a little better.
Should we be zipping to those maps?
It's not a great map.
Okay. I'll just let you describe then.
So, you're in like a stable house with like five stables in it, and you can hear sort of soft breathing coming from within those stables, but there's no light inside of these stables. The light is instead coming from outside of a door which must go underground into some underground passageway that is basically directly ahead of you. You have the option of sort of turning right and going deeper into this stable, which doesn't look particularly big. It's got about the same footprint as the manor, Scarlet's Manor. But ahead of you is a door where you can see a faint glowing light. Like it's just got like a, like if somebody's left the light on, if somebody put a candle in a closet, you've just got that rim around the door and it's very faint. But as soon as the screaming has gone on long enough outside, you hear a shout in the distance. Oi, what's going on out there? Kaya.
Yes.
You hear someone calling from inside the menagerie door, that first menagerie door. You can see a person holding a lamp back there, shouting at the servant and at the guards.
All right, so I will let Isolde know that that's what I see. The temptation to shoot that lamp is there, but I will resist it.
Isolde and Reed, you also heard that shouting, but it sounded distant and muffled by echoing through corridors.
Not coming from the closet door?
It came through there, but it sounds like it's around a few corners.
Okay.
So there is another exit from here. Good. Once they figure out what's going on, they might do a sweep and we might get caught in here. So we should try to move quickly, but we should avoid that person. If we hear footsteps coming towards us, we should hide or prepare for a fight.
Okay.
I would like you two to swap to the Under Harris Reka map.
Okie dokie.
Poor Kaya, sitting on her hill, all alone.
I mean, you're basically mission control. You can bring down the pain.
It's true.
So, you're down inside of this stables room. You hear soft breathing. You know what direction sort of out must be. You can go through the door, or you can go deeper into the stables. What do you do?
I look at Isolde.
Well, we should confirm that whoever's in these stalls isn't the Green Bark Gang.
Yeah, that would be super easy if that happened to be the case.
So you take a look over into these sort of perfectly normal-looking animal stables, and what you find are most of them contain a handful of Blood Hunter Tegu, so Rottweiler-sized lizards.
Great.
That you know are essentially the equivalent of bloodhounds. However, one of them has a bunch of sap spiders just kind of curled up and dormant. And in the center of them, of this little pile of them, is a faintly glowing red stone.
Holy shit.
Oh boy. Oh boy.
Not in the center of each sap spider, but sort of in the mass of an unknown quantity of them. They're kind of curled up around it and sleeping like it were a warm spot.
Oh boy, can I resist taking that? Oh man. I have to get a sample. Mysterious.
I don't know. Can you? Isolde, what do you do?
Reed, how much trouble am I in if I take that redstone and try to figure out what it is, what it does?
I don't know what it is. I mean, I know what it is, but I don't know what it does or how it works.
Is it an atrocity?
Maybe. Really, it was more what they do with it that's an atrocity, but...
What do they do with it?
Enslave. This is not the time.
Well, it seems likely that if I mess with it, those sap spiders will run amok.
That's a fair thing to be afraid of.
Yes, that is a fair thing to be afraid of.
So, I don't think we want that right now, but it's good to keep in mind in case we need a secondary distraction.
You guys are the most destructive cat burglars ever.
Christ. Is that the only interesting thing in the stalls?
Yeah, they're that's basically it. Bunches of Tegu in that one stall full of sap spiders.
So I guess we take a peek through that lit door?
Yeah.
All right, through the lit door, you see that you're at, like, a T intersection with a largely natural-looking cavern. It's been tooled a little bit, but only a very small amount. And the light is coming from... I'm trying to make a spot appear on the map. The light is coming from right here, just down that corridor. It looks like someone has set down a lantern. These spots right here, these things that are blocking the corridor to your left and to your right, those are like, not portcullises, because those have like a trellis shape to them, but like, they're wooden bars that have been slammed down into meeting slots at the ground, and they each one of those bars has a tiny fragment of that redstone on it.
Jesus.
How do people pass through them? Is there a door set in the... or an arch?
On the wall next to each of them, and it looks like there's one of these on both sides, is like a pump handle of sorts that you could pull, and that might be a door mechanism. There's one on either side of each of these doors.
That is not going to be quiet.
Right.
Shit. We might need to wait for her to parade them out and crash the party then.
Maybe. We still haven't confirmed where they are. Maybe if...
So you hear the shouts of fire? Fire? And that fellow from up ahead, near where that lantern light is coming from is... Oh shoot, what did he sound like earlier?
Kind of Australian, but not.
Oh, that's right. Oi, don't make me come over there and take care of this myself. It's just a little fire, you pansies. Kaya, you can see that now, like, four men are beating out the fire by having, like, torn their shirts off and are actually slapping the fire out. But Isold and Reed, you hear somebody say, like an echo down the corridor, "Yeah, it's just a little fire. You're not afraid of a little fire. You don't think someone's coming for you, do you? Coming for you, yeah. Yeah, Reed's gonna crush you. Yeah, just you wait."
Okay, that's confirmation.
Christ. Okay. Now what?
What do you do?
I think at Kaya and say, are they still distracted by the fire?
Most of them are. But not all.
There is a rear window leading up from the latrine. Do you see anyone on that?
There is no one on that.
No, I did not see anyone on that window.
Okay. Within the next 30 seconds, we're going to bust out that window. Reed, are you ready for that? Are you ready to... Do you think we should bust out of here? Are you with me?
Yeah, we gotta do this right the first time. And I don't think we can get through these doors.
We got confirmation. And I think we're gonna get something else. I'm gonna go over and I'm gonna start prepping my alchemist pouch to safely grab the redstone from that stall.
Do you want me to do that, Isolde? In case they get angry.
I want you to hold my staff. I want you to keep the door open. I want you to slam the stable door open. I want you to close it when I run out, because we're going to run.
Okay. Got it.
Now understand, it is a stable door like you would find in like a horse stable, so things can go over.
Sure. But there are spiders that are low that'll take them at least half a second to climb, and that half second is necessary for me with my short, stubby little legs to get just the slightest advantage.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Isolde, you, so you both get in position.
Yep.
Isolde, you reach out and you grab that stone with your hand, and immediately, the moment that you have moved it, those sap spiders, like, that You know that their bark skin, they're made of wood, for all as far as anyone knows, like strung together with sap muscles. You see that those sap muscles sort of come to life, and you notice that they're tinged red. They glow very faintly red, and the moment you touch that stone, they are alight. And you've got that stone in your hand, and they are leaping and clawing at you. They are trying to get you. What do you do?
Run!
I would like a Defy Danger dex.
I will assist with the plan that we said earlier, with the whole quick shutting of the door and batting away of things.
Please give me an aid to slam a door on a monster.
My aid is, my bond with Isolde is +2, so that's probably the closest approximation.
So you aid really well, but Isolde.
Got too greedy. Oh. I got too greedy. Now this is karma. This is fame.
Yeah. This is karma.
Yeah.
Isolde, let me see, what are the verbs that these guys have? Oh, they're totally, this is so bad.
Yeah, I got as good an aid as I can.
Yeah. Isolde, could you roll me 1d4?
Yeah.
Ouch.
Isolde, you take 3 damage when you're running out the door and you think you've gotten away scot-free. They tried to grab for your hand, they tried to grab, you know, for you, for your face, for your hair, but then you try to lift your right foot and it just doesn't go. And you slam face first onto the ground in front of that stable, and you manage to close the door, Reed. Uh-huh. But Isolde is her right leg is glued to the ground with this terrible sticky paste, and it's starting to burn through her leg. What do you do?
Well, I can't get it off her leg fast enough, but I do happen to have sharp things, and I can get it detached from the ground. I'm gonna cut her loose from the ground, pick her up, and we're hauling ass out of here.
That sounds like a plan.
Yeah.
The spiders are all atop of you. But you've got a Defy Danger dex. Isolde, you cannot assist because you are being carried. Give me a Defy Danger dex as these things, and you're definitely moving.
Okay, yes, definitely moving. Definitely dex. It's not the worst. It's an 8.
It's an 8. What is a partial success on that roll, Reed, again?
So that's just, it's just a modifier on a normal Defy Danger. So, Defy Danger, partial success, you stumble, hesitate, or flinch, GM offers you a worse outcome, hard bargain, or ugly choice. She's thinking.
I'm thinking because it's mean.
Well, yeah, that's a little bit your job.
But it's really mean.
Yeah.
They're clawing at you. And they get a hold of something, and you feel it tug. They're sticking to the walls and to the ceiling. They're swarming way faster than you've ever seen one of these things swarm. And you feel it tug on your axe, and you feel it tug on Isolde's hand. And you see that they've got one of those spindles attached both to your axe and to the little alchemist pouch that Isolde is holding. One of them has to get dropped, or you're going to be caught by these things. Is it going to be your weapon, or is it going to be the redstone?
Leave the redstone.
Yeah, that is my first instinct, actually.
They haven't found anything yet that links us to this place.
Yep. And also, like, we already know there's tons of redstone all over this fucking fortress. We will find you another sample to study.
Yeah.
I am throwing that pouch with the redstone into the furthest corner of the stable and continuing to get Isolde out as fast as I can.
You bolt up the stairs.
So that we can see to her leg, etc.
You bolt up the stairs and you see that as soon as that redstone is dropped, they're just dragging it to a corner. They're not even chasing you. They're just entirely fixated on it.
Well.
And you run up the stairs, and you run to the back of the manor house, and you go into the latrine room where there's this, you know, this polite-looking wooden door these wooden swinging doors, like saloon doors, going into the latrine room.
That's adorable.
Where it's not an entirely private latrine. It actually has multiple holes. Like, this is some place that apparently people do this as a group, because the past is tough. You find this little kind of narrow window, but it's big enough for you, Reed. It's big enough for Isold. And it even swings open to vent the room out.
Oh, how nice.
So you push that open. Yeah, you don't have to smash the window. Who goes out first?
Oh, man. I think I would put Isold out first.
I won't say no.
Because, well, actually, how far was the drop? If she slips and falls into the poop water, is she going to, like, break a leg or just be gross?
It's going to be about a total, because you're not, like, at exactly ground level when climbing out of that window.
Yeah.
And because the ditch is not insubstantial, it's still a 10-foot fall, and people do break their legs from that. That's a thing that happens to people, but it's not expected. If she slips and falls, she's going to get hurt and probably get a myriad diseases. Not that you guys know how that works. And so it's dangerous, but it's not like condemning her to die.
Well,
it would be safer if you went first and I climbed after you.
Okay.
I imagine.
Fine.
So they're climbing out this window and I can see it from where I am, right?
Yes, you see that window fly open and you see what is clearly a brief moment of discussion as to who goes first.
Okay, so do I have time to launch an arrow with a rope attached to it to, like, just above the window so they can have something to use to get out the window and safely descend?
You don't have that much rope?
I wasn't going to connect it to me.
Oh, you're going to launch a coil of rope.
Yeah, just launch some rope so they can get down safely. Not enough rope for them to get to me, but just, like, some rope, like 10 feet.
That's
5 feet.
That's real tough.
Okay.
That is a difficult thing to do, but I will let you do that as a... Oh, let's give it a... It's a weird use of it, but let's use volley.
Okay.
Just so that you have those weird side effects from the volley action.
Okay. Okay, so that's a roll plus dex. 11.
That'll do. You don't even have to choose any of the tough things. Here's what I like, is you didn't warn them about this ahead of time. Reed and Isold, just as Reed is about to go climbing out, this arrow slams into the wall next to the window as it's swinging out, and hanging from it is this, like, bundle of rope.
Thought you could very use some thoughtful. Rope.
Very thoughtful.
Thanks for the heads up, Kaya. No, it was good job.
Hey.
All right.
I tied some rope to an arrow and shot it right next to you. Come on.
I'm genuinely impressed. Okay, I'm genuinely let's go. Impressed. Let's go.
Let's the go. Front I'm, door I'm... flies open.
Go.
We're going.
So you go. You give me. It matters
and
if you stumble.
I'm gonna try and pull the arrow and the rope out after me once I'm gone. Once Isold's safe and I'm gone.
They're on the exterior of the building.
Yeah, someone can look out the window.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sure. So that means you're going. You're helping Isold out, and then Isold's actually making the first escape.
Yes.
Isold, give me an aid, Reed.
Oh, yeah.
That's what this is for.
What am I rolling?
It's really funny that I'm using my con to roll my aid, but I have as much bond with Isold as my con bonus, so.
And Isold, you'll be rolling a Defy Danger dex.
I've been not spectacular at those recently.
I know, but you've got a plus, you've got an additional plus one.
Okay, that does put me over the top into...
That puts you over the top. You've never felt so graceful in your life. Maybe it is the searing pain in your leg. Maybe it's the thrill of having grabbed the redstone and had it there in your hot little hands. But you swing out that window, you get a helping hand from Reed, and you just fling out across the, like, that weird corner over the ditch and back onto dry land.
I feel pretty.
And you are safe and clear.
I feel like we buckled some swashes, maybe swashed some buckles right there.
Yeah, it was super swashbuckly. Reed, someone is rushing towards the back of the manor house. You hear footsteps inside. People are clearly rushing in. They're rushing up the stairs. They're rushing down the stairs. And they're rushing deeper into the manor.
I'm getting that rope out of the wall right this second, and I'm getting out of sight the fastest way I can. If that is swinging over to where Isolde is, awesome. If that is going under the house in the poop water, that's not as awesome, but it's whatever comes first.
You're a big, tall lady. Give me a Defy Danger dex to make the leap to Isolde, because you totally could.
That is much preferred. Defy Danger dex caused by jumping a lot?
Yep.
Movement is jumping.
I get a plus to that.
Boom.
That works. You rip the arrow out of its spot, you know, getting that rope anchor that would have saved any of you if you had fallen, and you leap over next to Isolde, just as you guys, like, throw yourselves against the fortress wall, just as a head pops out that window, looks left, looks right, sneers at the darkness, and then pulls itself back into the manor. There are guards running around, shouting things. Someone has recovered that first arrow that shattered the lantern. They know that there was an archer that shot at them.
Oh, I'm
and
hiding.
They're... That's good. Where are you going to hide?
Well, this is a... I thought you said this was like a garden-y area.
Yeah, there's some nice stuff up there. The garden is actually on the east side of the building.
Ah, well, is there vegetation or is there no vegetation?
There's no vegetation. You are like 100 feet up. You could crouch or you could go
flat
in and get some tea.
Like a sniper. It's awesome.
I'm going to lay flat like a sniper because I'm so far above them that they won't see me if I'm flat.
Oh, yeah. And at this point, you could just leisurely go and get some tea and everything would be fine.
This is my plan. Tea sounds delightful. Yeah. I'm going to tell Isolde, let me know if you... Are you guys cool? What can I... I'll stay and watch. I'm not going to go get tea. My teammates are still down there and could perhaps use Eye in the Sky.
You guys catch up with Shimshackle at sort of the center of the wall there. He's like, okay... Hey guys, what did you find? Wow, all of us Greenbarks sound alike. Darn.
It's a regional accent. I've been studying it in my ethnography classes.
Yeah, this is great. What did you find? Oh, Isolde. Isolde, your pretty little leg. It's all burned up.
Oh, hazards of the job. Chemical burns happen all the time among alchemists. You wouldn't happen to have any bandages, would you?
No, I've only got my knife here, Justice Revenge. And she doesn't have any bandages. we probably could get those at any tent.
Yeah.
Or where are you guys staying? Where's all your stuff?
Up the manor house.
Oh, sweet. That's cool.
Right. If you could go and procure some bandages for me, I can't be seen in this state until I'm fixed up.
That's real tough. I can't be seen in town.
Yeah. I guess that leaves me.
If you wouldn't mind.
Are you sure you don't want me to just piggyback you back up to the manor or something?
I still have my pride. Even though I'm mightily embarrassed by...
Embarrassed? You were like a cat over there. Just grace and speed.
Losing the redstone. Getting splashed on.
Mauled by spiders.
By some spider goo. Wow.
Honestly, it's not that different from running in the forest.
I would note, since Reed has her big-ass cloak... / cape thing.
You could hide your burnedness if you needed to.
Yeah, you could just put the cloak over Isolde and no one would know.
Yes.
If that's what you're concerned about.
Well, I am partly concerned with actually fixing up my leg.
Well, let's get you back to where your stuff is, where you can, you know, potion up some potiony.
If you want closer, I mean, Barker probably has something. We could probably get something at the Beyond, other than just drinks.
Would you like Kai is just gonna kind of say to Isolde, so do you need anything? Should I come down there?
Right. If you could bring my spare set of clothes.
From the room. Okay. Do you want the purple robes or the green robes?
I think she's wearing the purple robes, so it will be the green ones then.
Green robes.
Okay.
Slytherin pride. Wait, what? No.
Boom.
Slytherin, the school of technical and ethnographic. Fuck that. That didn't come out well. Tactical and ethnographic studies.
Slytherclaw?
Slytherclaw.
Slytherclaw, indeed.
I don't endorse this. I don't endorse this at all. What have I done?
Okay, so you come back. Kaya, you rejoin them with some bandages and a spare, not burned robe for Isolde. And there you go, zipping across the map like you do.
It's so nice.
And you're able to do some level of first aid. They're chemical burns, and so there's really surprisingly little that you can do.
Mm-hmm.
You can put some neutralizing agent from your kit and sort of pray for the best.
Right. Bandages are an equipment under dungeon gear.
Wait, really? Yes. Are they? I had no idea.
Looking to use them to heal some damage, heal some hit points.
Oh.
I didn't actually
know they were a real piece of gear.
Rules for items. So is that from dungeon gear or adventure gear?
It's under dungeon gear on page 226.
Yep, I see it. They heal 4 damage and expend with a use, but I don't. Do any of you actually have bandages?
No.
You would
actually need to acquire them. Okay.
I thought it was just flavor text.
Yeah, so did I.
There are rules and mechanics in this game? What?
I'm such a rules lawyer, I know.
Ridiculous. So Kaya's gonna kind of look and be like, so do we need to get some bandages? I could probably take us to Edvar's tent. He offered to help if I needed help, and I think we might be time to enlist some additional aid. No one is really happy with what Scarlet's doing. Maybe we should get some additional aid.
We should feel out Barker. And I know that Venamo is opposed to this.
Are we not saying phrasing anymore? Anyway.
Phrasing?
I will tell you all this. You are all exhausted. Remember, this is the same day that you've walked probably 20 miles.
Yeah, maybe more. We need to sleep, guys. We need some rest if we're going to do our best. If you don't have your health, so you don't have anything.
The proposition to go see Edvard in order to get bandages, or to see Barker to get bandages and feel them out, that makes perfect sense, but it's not like... It would be a very bad time to kind of split up and try to hit up contacts this late at night.
Right, no, bad plan. Get bandages, go rest.
Yelp.
Also, I'd point out you don't need literal bandages if you were to just do kind of your own field dressing and go to sleep.
Let's do that.
Oh, is that how that works?
You get half your hit points back.
Oh,
right.
Let's do
half
that.
Your max hit points.
Let's do that.
Let's rest up. Start an early day tomorrow.
Sure.
So we do have confirmation where they are. It's just a matter of figuring out how we want to go about this. We may have to pull a Robin Hood, like you said, and save them in broad daylight.
We might be able to get more help with that, but we're going to have to get started early recruiting it.
Well, let's go get some rest right now. It's late enough as it is.
I think I might be able to get a head start on both of those things. I will see the two of you in the morning, or sooner if this goes very poorly.
Okay.
Watch yourself.
Okay,
watch yourself, Reed.
So Reed goes her separate way.
Reed goes separate. Going to bed.
Sorry. Reed had a proposition made last session that she is kind of keen on following up on. And,
Kaya,
you know...
Kaya and Isolde, I'm going to handle a bit of... bit of this with you guys first.
Right.
You come up and one of the servants that you charmed actually, Isolde.
Yes.
is actually still up there waiting. They've been ordered to, you know, make certain that you guys get comfortably to your rest, and see to any laundry that you might have if you, for some reason, needed laundry done. Baron Nyland was very clear on this.
I am starting to really like Baron Nyland. She is a sneaky person.
She's interesting, that's for sure.
Yes.
And as such, you have any kind of supplies that you need and can go to sleep quite easily, if that is what you wish to get up to immediately.
That is what Kaya will do. Isolde is of course free to make her own choices.
Yep, nap time.
Oh, although when you do go into your apartment, the head is over the bed.
Well, that won't last. That won't last.
I'm gonna take my staff and nudge it aside.
Yeah.
The head scared is to so, touch it with your bare hands.
So creepy, Isolde. So creepy.
It moves. The bed is like ice cold. This room is warm because they have a fire going in the other room and it's just sort of ambiently warms this place. The bed and only the bed is cold.
It's great. Oh, Kai is gonna look at the head and go like, thanks, I hate to sleep hot. Dive down, pull the covers over herself, cuddle up with Angus. I haven't had cold sheets in weeks.
If Herman could shrug, Herman would. Reed, the beyond is finally, it looks like it had been quieting down, but as soon as the fire calls started going out, it looks like several of its tenants got up and ran to help and have actually already returned.
I did try to come into the beyond as if I had been somewhere in the tent city. I've been slightly taught how to be sneaky by compatriots.
Great job. So you get in and nobody sort of thinks that this is particularly odd, other than that you're, you know, 7 feet tall and
limping because I sprained my ankle.
And limping with your sprained ankle still. Barker is still awake and sees you and offers you that drink he owes you.
I thought it was the other way around.
Oh, that's right.
Like,
that's right,
I
that's
lost
right.
the race.
All right, you'll buy me a drink, and then I'll buy you a drink, and we'll see how this goes down.
I could use that. Yeah, let's not fill this podcast with fanfic.
Let's not fill this podcast. It goes down, and you stay in his room?
Let's assume that the non-mechanical, not involving our heist parts go well. Is that safe?
Yeah, that's fine. That goes great.
Awesome. Cool.
You're both like badly injured people, actually. Very recently badly injured. And so this is actually a much more caring thing than you would expect it to be.
Aww.
Yeah, it's actually really sweet. It's a sweet scene.
The mechanical side of all this, that at some point, hanging out with Barker before meeting back up with the gang in the morning, probably I might give a try to this call in a favor thing, but
I'm trying
to think of what I am gonna ask. I don't know what to ask for in specifics. Do I need to?
You need to have your request that you would like to make. So the two of you wake up in the morning and he's like, actually, Abel Public, he has this stew, I think it's leftover stew from last night, and that shouldn't be a thing that anybody eats, but nonetheless, it is the most delicious thing. Why don't you and I get that and, I guess, go about our days? I hear that your day's gonna be busy.
Yeah, I could probably use some help with that.
What kind of trouble are you thinking of starting, kid?
Well,
you got a jailbreak and you got a gallows.
Actually, out of character real quick, remind me, the sign said that they were going to be thrown in to see how long they last.
That's correct. After the exercises, after the troop exercises. So it's going to be late afternoon, essentially.
Okay.
And they're going to be, and it's a show. Everyone's invited to watch the Green Barks get it.
Do we actually know what that means? Like, how is this? We've seen the place. We know that it's clearly a fighting arena of some kind, but what are they going to be pitted against? I know she's got crazy, weird sap spiders.
So I'm going to cut away from you real quick. Isolde and Kaya, in the night, you are visited by terrible, terrible dreams. And you have the choice to either succumb to the dream and know a little of what's going to happen, or you can try to resist it and you won't be hurt. What do you do?
I mean, suffering pain for knowledge? Love it. Succumbing to the dream.
Succumbing to the dream.
Okay, both of you roll 1d8.
Roll low.
Yeah, roll low.
Oh, good job, Isolde.
That's not so great, Kaya.
What did each of you roll?
Well, Isolde rolled a 1. Kaya rolled a 6.
Okay. You both chose something, and so, Isolde, you get an image of that tunnel and the tunnel underneath the manor. And you see that swarm of sap spiders rushing up at you, and you see your own hand, but it doesn't look like your hand. It looks like somebody else's. Somebody dirty with cloth feet, with cloth shoes, scrambling backwards and reaching up to that pump handle on the wall and sliding it. And each pump brings the gate just a little bit higher. And then just as they crawl through, just as the sap spiders are coming to get them, just the first one claws at their feet, they press that pump handle all the way to the top, and the door slams closed, and those sap spiders lurch away from the bars that drop down. You take 1 damage.
Okay.
Kaya, you are standing in the center of that arena, right where that man was clearing out those holes in the ground. And you see that the center door opens inside of the arena. The center sort of garage door gate opens up with this creaking sound. And through it, you see a sapling. 10 feet tall, 15 feet tall maybe. As it walks forward on its crab legs with its crab claws. And it opens the center of its... on its trunk. It's got the form of a young man, maybe even a child, and it splits right down the middle and opens up, revealing this leathery interior to the tree of this sapling monster. And as you're transfixed by that, it claws your leg, splits your leg wide open. You can see the bone sticking out, and you see your blood fall to the ground and drip through that hole beside you. It's like there's a gradient to the ground, and it guides the blood to those holes.
Oh, my Lord.
And you wake up. You wake up, and you see that your leg is burned by frostbite, and the shadow pulls its hand away.
Oh.
You remember something special and strange about that sapling. All of its leaves were red.
Mm-hmm.
Bright red. Barker turns to you, Reed, and he says, "She's got all kinds. But her pride and joy, what she likes to pit the men against. She has this sapling. It's her little pet. It's what we train against. She can make it stop. She holds up this necklace to stop it. But she awaits until the last second, because the men need to know how it fights. That's what she'll use. She's got spiders. They can't go across the edge. That whole arena is rimmed in those redstones. Nothing can get out of it. But she stops the fight by jumping in herself with that necklace of hers. Some of her men have them, too.
And she's just not going to jump in this time.
She's probably just not going to jump in this time.
Mm.
That sounds mighty mean to me. Want to even the odds?
I would like that.
You ever taken one of them down?
I never have.
We could, you and I. Get a little back for lost friends. How's that sound to you, Reed?
That sounds terrifying, but like the kind of help that I would need to at least stall long enough to get the rest of the gang out of that pit.
Do you want to ask for that help?
Yeah, I do.
Then use the call in a favor move.
Let's see how bad this goes.
Let's see how bad this goes. Roll plus cha.
Plus cha. That's not the worst.
Yeah.
I get to choose two from this list. I get to choose two out of these four options.
Could you read all of the options off?
All the options are, your request is going to cost extra. Your request is going to take some time. Your request is going to attract unwanted attention, complications, or consequences. Or your ally needs you to help them out with something. If you turn them down, take -1 ongoing to this move till you make it right.
Which two are you going to take?
He's going to make a request for me to help with something, and it's going to take some time to put together.
All right. And the other one you take is your ally needs help with something?
Yep.
All right. There's something I need. That head you brought is important, but it's not the whole thing. And the Baron, she doesn't know what she's done. I don't know what she's done neither, but I can tell that it's bad. There's a door at the bottom of the fortress. In the storeroom, there at the base. It's a trap door that goes down. When we've sprung your friends, and we've gotten out of this trouble, I need you to go down there with me and we're gonna wreck something. We're gonna wreck it good.
You think you know what can destroy one of these things?
I think that while it's still not finished, it could be broken.
Oh, good lord. They are putting it together.
Oh, yeah. You take that head down there and it's going to fit right into place and all hell's going to break loose.
I think you're right, and I will help you break this thing.
All right. I gotta get some friends together. We're gonna take this creature down right.
It's, there's, quite a show we've got to put on.
Yeah. When you hop in there, when I see you in the ring, I'll be right with you.
Thanks.
He, leaves, but he leaves enough weight on the table to buy your breakfast.
Aw, somewhere in there he figured out that I am as yet penniless.
Isolde and Kaya.
Yes.
You've woken up from your hideous dreams, and you're now injured again. Great.
So we got the injury, and then we got the restoration?
No, you got the restoration from sleeping, and you woke up with these injuries.
Okay. Ow. I'm only down one hit point from total.
That was not the...
Kaya's not doing great.
Kaya's not doing that well. Yep.
Yeah, and you, you're vaguely aware of the existence of Frostbite. Now you can see it.
Yep. I glare at the head. That was petty.
You said you liked cold sheets.
Wow. Herman. Dick move.
Yeah, Herman. You're way to make friends and influence people, Herman.
Yeah, that looks awful. That frostbite.
Yeah, do you have anything that can help with frostbite, Isolde?
I mean, I do have this healing potion.
Oh.
Or I could try scrounging up some herbs and poultices.
Well, I'm going to go sparring with the Baron after breakfast. Probably be good to not make a poor showing with what we've got going on.
If you could figure out if she, you know, figure out more about her relationship with the Scarlet Gang.
Yeah, that was kind of my thought. She didn't seem too keen on what Scarlet's doing, but she's definitely profiting from the results of it. So it's kind of one of those mobster in your back pocket type situations, is my guess.
Right. She seems to need the redstone.
Yeah. Wonder if she needs more or if she has enough. Angus, be quiet.
So, Isolde, Kaya, it sounds like you want to go through with having breakfast and exercises with
the Baron.
Baron Nyland.
Baron Nyland. Yes, that is what Kaya wants to do.
Isolde, do you want to take part in that or do you want to see someone else?
Well, I would like to prepare spells.
What spells do you want to prepare?
Right, so today's spells are Charm Person, Magic Missile, and Telepathy.
Great. Do you want to try to use the Telepathy now between the two of you, or do you want to try to get the gang together first?
I'll wait till I get the gang together first.
On that note, Reed does know that she was planning on meeting up with the gals for breakfast so that we could figure out who's talking to what, when, where, and maybe try and get in on that telepathy, since, you know, that seemed to be a thing.
Yeah.
I guess if you want to take them, you can have 2 coin.
Yeah, you don't have to eat the breakfast that
think
he's picked.
I think Reed is oblivious as to why he left his weird shiny rocks there.
Reed, yeah,
again,
nuts.
Is not from a currency-using group.
It's true.
She's still not used to it, and thus, you know, foggy, groggy in the morning, doesn't realize what that is.
I mean, Izzold is more familiar with it, but even then, Izzold, you're used to using credit, essentially.
Right.
Because, yeah, that's the kind of society you're from.
Oh, you people and your weightlessness.
Reed, are you eschewing a convention of civilization?
I think she just
did. I think I am.
Wow.
What? Hooray!
That's a great job. You can all have breakfast with the Baron if you would like, but I will say that the essentially breakfast time slot is one of a very limited number of things that you can get done today.
It is the most important meal of the day.
Oh.
Or so I've heard.
Well, I think that sitting down with the Baron and talking over breakfast is what Kaya thinks will be useful, because she would like to try to do the whole get the Baron on her side thing.
Sure. Do the rest of you want to have breakfast? I mean, you all have various invitations to hang out with people as well.
I mean, I mostly wanted to get the telepathy opportunity.
Okay, so you all meet up in the apartment prior to having breakfast. If you want to get the telepathy thing
Absolutely.
Going, now is your time.
Let's do this thing.
Cast a spell. Network us all up. I am going to cast telepathy. Mixing up that weird Quicksilver concoction.
Yeah, it turns into a mist and then you inhale it. Jesus Christ.
Well.
Wow.
There goes that spell.
Well, it's a plus 2. Do you have +2 for it?
Yeah.
I was going to ask, can I help? Because this would be my 3rd time to do this telepathy spell with Isild, so I'm kind of familiar with it.
I will give you, because you're also guiding Reed through doing it right this time,
yes.
then you can totally roll an aid, because that will be enough to get you guys above a 7. And I don't want to have you guys without telepathy entirely. Okay, that's great.
Hooray.
Are you going to... which of the 3 options are you going to take, Professor Izzold?
Well, I'm going to lose the prepared spell and
okay.
have telepathy with Kaya. Sorry,
okay.
Reed. One of
that
these
all
days,
makes sense.
One of these days.
One of these days.
You each flashback to having Reed's thoughts in your head and are just like, one of these days.
One of these days.
It'll
be nice.
Just not today.
Not today. Might not be bad. You know, Reed's going to be pretty caught up in her own head anyway.
It's true.
Reed, you are all in the manor house, or in the fortress. Do you want to tell them what you've arranged with Barker, or do you want to hold on to that?
I do want to tell them, and specifically I want to tell them about the necklace that he told me about.
Ah.
Being how she seems to control the sapling.
And she's the only one with a necklace?
He said that some of her guards have necklaces too, but he didn't say that they can command it.
Hmm.
So, I feel like that's probably something we should try and chase down. I don't know if... I mean, I could try to chase that down. I can probably intimidate the shit out of some of her underlings. Or hell, I mean, that's probably something someone has seen. I can try and chase that down today.
Chase down where the necklace is?
And whether the guards' necklaces do a damn.
Ah.
Because if there's more than one necklace, it's going to be much easier
to
maybe get a hold of one.
So who's going to breakfast with Baron Nyland?
Well, definitely
Kaya.
Should I...
I think I made an ass of myself last time I had food with the Baron. I don't want to, like... make things worse for folks.
Now, do you want me to help Kaya with working over
Nyland trying to get her on, get a favor out of her?
I think that her aid could be powerful. If we can get her help, that could be the deciding factor for sure. She theoretically is in charge of a lot here.
Right.
If you have another source of aid that you would like to work with, then that's something maybe you should do, but you know.
I know that Venamo has an interest in helping us. Or,
oh, that's right.
But I don't trust him. I trust him less than Nyland.
Nyland is out for herself, but her motivations are right there out in front. At least a lot of them. She's been fairly straightforward with us.
Reed, did you tell them about his request?
Sure.
I remind you, before you say sure, I remind you that you are in the fortress.
Oh, no.
Okay.
That is interesting.
Well, actually, I might do Reed's version of kind of going at it sideways, which is saying Barker seems to have similar thoughts as Herman about this whole statue business.
Okay.
And if that doesn't make sense, I'll just shrug.
Okay, so Reed leaves to go have breakfast someplace else. Isolde, are you staying?
Yeah, I'd like to help convince Baron Nyland to help us.
Okay.
So you each sit down to breakfast, and Nyland does not seem disappointed that Reed has decided to move on. She doesn't make any, like, dismissive comments. She doesn't say anything rude or tacky. It's just that she and Reed didn't get along the best.
No.
I'm glad that the two of you have decided to join me, and that I trust that you slept well, despite the ruckus.
Well, we came in after the ruckus. We went down to Able Publics for a while and came in decently late and slept as well as we could. I have to decide.
Oh, I'm certain I was. I could definitely have been mistaken. I could have sworn that you were in the apartment when the trouble happened. But
trouble?
If that's not the case.
There was trouble? I do recall hearing some noise at some point. What
trouble are you speaking of?
Oh, it seems that there was a break-in down at the menagerie.
Really? How unfortunate. I hope nothing was taken from you.
Oh, nothing was taken from me. I don't know of anything that was taken, but I'll be certain to find out from Scarlet whether she can be trusted with the important treasures kept in the menagerie.
Indeed, that is concerning that she might not be able to be trusted with the things that you have put in her care.
Yes, it would be truly terrible if there were another demonstration of her inability to protect the things that she's agreed to protect.
Indeed, did you know what she had planned? We were down at Able Publics early in the evening, and did you know that she has these plans for the Greenbark gang to kill them today?
Oh, no, I didn't actually. I've been in my room until.
Well, you'd heard of the trouble, so I didn't know if your servants had informed you of this as well.
No, they'd only told me, you know, fire and that kind of thing.
Fire?
Yeah, a terrible fire down at the menagerie. What a surprise.
I wonder if that affected the inhabitants of the menagerie. I hope that nothing got loose.
Oh, I hope nothing got loose.
That would be unfortunate.
I will have to check that out.
Yes.
I'm glad to hear that you were definitely not involved and are concerned with Scarlet and the menagerie's safety.
We are, of course, concerned that your interests be protected.
Oh, good.
You are our host. We would never want your interests to be not served while we are your guests. Scarlet, however, is not our host, so we feel less protective to her. But you are our host, so we would never want your interests to be disturbed while we are your guests.
So she's gonna do in the Greenbark gang.
Yeah.
That's the plan that I've heard.
This is what the sign said. And it's the sentiments that we've heard around, we heard, were not terribly positive towards this cruel act.
She has fans amongst the soldiers that think that they enjoy her showmanship. They enjoy the way that she teaches them how to fight against the forest. She has a way about her that makes people fond enough. Her penchant for cruelty, especially now that she's maybe going to feed the greenbarks to her creatures.
That's concerning.
I cannot be seen directly interfering with that. I do not wish it done. But if you are subtly asking for my help, I will not be able to influence this directly. Not without some grounds to step in. Some breach of contract or some significant failure on her part.
Ah, so if she had failed to keep the contents of the menagerie secure, would that be such a breach?
Secure or alive, something significant were to die in her care, she would be in breach of contract with our agreements.
Indeed.
And I would have reason to take over for the protection of the national treasures that are within the menagerie.
Indeed.
If that happened while the Greenbarks were still alive, they are, at this time, tied to that land.
Are they now?
We recognize that they were not born inside of the Empire, but once they began doing their business here, they became bound to the land just like any other serf. They were never made freemen, they are criminals. As such, they are the property of the land here. They have been transferred from one owner to another. They were transferred to me. They've been transferred to Venamo. And now they currently rest as Scarlet's property. But in the end, it's always in the service of the Empire.
Of course.
Of the good people here.
Of course.
They have to be guided, of course.
Of course.
So,
your guidance.
If she were unfit, then it would be a different story.
Okay.
Now I will note, you guys can, if you'd like, you can do the call in a favor move. You won't be able to, you could possibly get gear from her, because she has vast stores of stuff, and that wouldn't be seen as coming from her directly. Mm-hmm. And even though she is a military power, she can't lend you soldiers to fight, because she's currently contractually bound.
Mm-hmm.
Or you could just leave this discussion sort of as it is.
I would like to request some healing items, bandages,
yeah,
or herbs and poultices.
I think
that sounds like a,
yeah,
that's great. Do a call in a favor for that, and she can raid the stores probably.
All right, rolling charisma. That's a
dude.
That's a nope. That's a nope rope.
Ouch.
That's a total of 5. I am marking XP.
Yay.
Mark XP, good job.
Drink.
She looks around and she looks briefly to her two servants. And she says, with a certain amount of showmanship, I'm sorry, but I cannot be seen providing you with any direct material aid at this point. Might I recommend, though, that the brothers below, the druid orders are outside of my command. They live by their own law. I'm certain that they can be of assistance.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
So is Isild going to go and see the brothers?
I am going to make a quick note that something bad has happened.
Yeah.
And I have advanced the Scarlet Clock. She's aware that you have been asking around town for some help.
Yep.
Oh, goody.
Yep.
Reed, where did you go?
I'm thinking I'm probably going to want to try and find a good spot to start trying to get some gossip.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I would know, since I left from the Beyond, if that would mean going back to the Beyond.
I mean, it's not a big town.
I mean, the alternative is trying to poke in and see how the barracks is doing. I know some of those mercenaries and soldiers were getting in a tussle last night.
So those fighters that got in the tussle were Crenshaw Wild's Cragsmith fighters.
Oh, I thought they got in a tussle with the locals.
No, these are the tussle was within a mercenary company.
Oh, I misunderstood. Okay.
Because this is a little abstracted, if you go to, like, hit up the bar for rumors or anything like that...
Yeah, basically.
I would like you to actually, like, pick a person that you end up talking to.
From say, this list, for example.
From, say, this list of the denizens of the Beyond. You also, I will admit, Olaf is around.
Oh, not yet. Though, maybe.
You know who he is.
I know who
he
is.
And he's awake.
It's true.
And you'll notice that some people on this list you've never met, but you know by reputation, or they just happen to be important enough that I wasn't going to deny their existence to you.
Yeah. I'm kind of interested in actually talking with the innkeep himself. Herself? Actually, the name's kind of gender neutral, I'm not sure. Able Public.
Would you like Able Public to be a boy or a girl?
Oh, gosh. I don't even know.
Or actually a man or a woman.
Thank you. I don't care. Whatever's easier for you.
It's easier for me to be a boy, so I'm gonna be, this is a man. I've updated the sheet. Able Public, man. So you go to the pub where people are taking in their early breakfast, and some more waiters or servers are going about making certain that everybody's eaten, but it's definitely far less populated than it was last night.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people seem to be nursing hangovers, but as soon as you've sat down, a jolly looking, never trust a thin chef is something you've heard. And this is definitely not a thin human being. This large man in simple clothes and a smock, you know, like not a butcher's smock or anything, but a kitchen smock.
Mm-hmm.
Comes up to you and sets a stew ahead of you and is like, "It's your first time in town. This one's on the house. If you just give us a little news from the outside. Everybody saw you come in. But we haven't been formally met. I'm Abel Public, the owner of this establishment." He holds out his hand to, like, wave to the establishment, and you see that he has gold rings on every finger.
He's doing well for himself.
He's doing great. "What brings you to my humble establishment?"
"Well, I'm not one to kiss and tell, but I hear that the breakfast here is astonishingly good."
This is it. This is the creme de la creme. It is the best breakfast you'll get on well, this side of that ditch."
"Good enough for me."
"Are you in town for the show this afternoon?"
"Bet your socks I am."
That's strange. I hadn't marked you as a fan of the sport."
"Oh, I intend to be a competitor."
"Oh, you're going to jump in yourself."
"Name's Impediment Reed."
Oh, you are Impediment Reed. I'll stop playing dumb for that one. You're going to save the Greenbark gang, are you?"
"It's my intent. I imagine there is a lot of money going to be tossed around as to whether they'll survive today or not."
"Yeah, the bet is on the order in which they go." "Should I add someone else to that list?"
"I'd like to put on the list that they won't go today. At least not in their entirety."
"Is that you volunteering to go first, or are you saying someone else is going to be on that list?"
"Hard to say."
"Oh.
I'm not really very familiar with the proceedings. I've heard, normally there's a way that the, onslaught is called off. Reed is fishing for call in a favor to get lore and try and find out more about these necklaces."
Sure. Yeah, yeah. You use your equally criminal ways to sort of sweet talk this innkeeper a bit.
I'm gonna have to roll dice, aren't I? Right, I'm in the wrong.
You're gonna have to roll dice. I want you to actually roll two different dice.
Oh.
But the first thing I want you to do is to do a discern reality wisdom.
Oh shits! All right, discern reality. It passes. Not the best, but it passes.
So give me take one question from the discern realities list.
I mean, do I go with my favorite, or do I go with something that's probably more imminently helpful? I would like what here is not what it appears to be. Is that not what you expected?
No, that's a fine one.
It's my favorite.
It's your favorite. There are a lot of people in this bar, but you're paying attention. Well, you're asking around, so you're trying to get information.
Mm-hmm.
And he knows that you're a criminal.
Well, or I have been.
Or you have been. Nah, he doesn't. He has no doubt in his mind. He tells you, there's a new gang in town that's looking for some muscle. You might be good for it, as could your friends when you spring them. Go speak to Unbound over there. And, do you want the acrobat entertainer? Is that a man or a woman?
Yes.
Fine.
What's in their pants? Wisdom.
Wisdom. Go talk to Unbound and they'll get you sorted.
Okay. Alright. This is exciting.
So, give me that call in a favor. Charisma.
Sure. That's charisma. That's this one. Oh, jeez.
You're gonna do your pick too.
Oh, man. Is this the time to attract attention? It doesn't feel right quite yet.
So which two are you gonna pick, Brianna?
Cost extra, and I'm either going to attract unwanted attention, complications, or consequences. Because I realize that this discussion has been maybe a little forward and cocky, and Reed is a bragger.
Yep, yep. I'm advancing a clock.
Yeah, God, which one? Yeah, yeah.
Yep, preparation is has advanced. Another step.
It's not Scarlet. That's good.
You've gotten some attention. Yeah, I understand that while preparation is against Scarlet, preparation is sort of like the defenses that will be arrayed against you at the actual menagerie.
Oh, great.
As opposed to Scarlet hiring Unbound to kill you.
Okay, that's great.
That would be getting Scarlet's attention.
I'm still curious what this third one is.
Yeah, you don't know what that is yet. If preparation goes all the way up, she moves up the execution.
Okay. That's bad.
Yeah, you don't want that to max out. And the other one you chose was cost extra?
Yes.
So he says he's going to get the information you need. This is going to be the thing that gives you the intel.
Mm-hmm.
But you got to get for him 20 coin.
Okay.
And he doesn't particularly care what you do to scrounge that up. Just come back with the coin or something valuable, and I'll be able to fix you right up. Unless you got 20 coin on you right now. But you're new in town, and you're one of the forest kids. I've actually gotten kind of used to you keeping empty pockets.
Yeah. Yeah.
Shit. Actually, you passed the charisma thing, so he's not going to actually delay you. He's gonna say you owe me the 20 coins, but he tells you something worth knowing, and you gain an intel.
Okay.
But you owe him 20 coins.
Yeah, I'm gonna work on figuring out how the hell you make coins anyway.
Yeah, your two friends can do that, or you could actually call in a favor with someone to get money.
Jesus Christ.
Too bad Barker's not around.
Eh. Eh.
Eh.
I already asked him for something pretty big.
Isolde and Kaya.
Yes?
Only one of you is going to get a turn here. Who wants to go to do a thing to be the sort of the last action? Or you could both go together. The exercises are starting, so Baron Nyland is now practicing with the troops, or will be practicing with the troops.
So Kaya's plan was to go practice with Baron Nyland and the troops in order to gain faction, as it were, with Baron Nyland and with her troops. She wants to kind of be a presence and seen as an equal alongside Baron Nyland by her troops.
That sounds like something to accomplish that isn't just, like, that seems like it's got narrative weight, but it isn't going to have a mechanical sort of role to it. Like, I'm not going to injure you or put you into that circumstance for doing that. Then we're gonna actually move on to Izzold. Izzold?
Well,
who are you going to go hit up?
I was going to talk to the druids.
You can talk to any of them that you wish.
Okay. The riskier one would be talking to Venamo, because I wanted to feel out what exactly he wanted with respect to the Greenbark gang, because I know that he wants that. Right. So I'm going to go talk to him. Talk to Brother Venamo.
Okay. So you head down to where the druids are, and they're actually doing like this morning ritual with their campfire. They've set aside their breakfast Dutch oven that they were heating something up in, and they're now like tossing some alchemical ingredients into the fire and saying some prayers as you approach. And Brother Venamo says, you know, Professor Izzold, it is such a pleasure to see you this morning.
Oh, good morning, brother.
How might our humble order be of service to you?
Oh, I was poking around to see if you had any bandages or poultices or herbs.
Oh, of course, we do. Do come in. And he opens the reliquary door and motions you to follow.
Thank you, brother.
Now, just inside the door, he's got, essentially, like, it seems like they've got just stacks and boxes and bookshelves of just like random alchemical stuff. Like when you see that the alchemist supplies inside of like any martial arts film, it's those drawers and drawers of stuff.
Is there a Mogwai for sale?
There's not a Mogwai for sale. However, there is a lot of weird things on these tables. So it looks like, despite the fact that this building is only like a little more than a story tall, it looks like it's actually had like a second floor put into its stone interior. Has a low roof, a low wooden roof, and it looks like they've sort of added a second floor attic to this building. And if it's anything like the first floor, there are these like displays, these heavy desks with like objects inside of sometimes glass cases or cages, or inside of, like, you've got just an elaborate, like, wooden box. It's like this guy's keeping Warehouse 13 in here. All sorts of, oh, a piece of a statue. Oh, just a strange plant. Oh, what appears to be a tegu, but completely covered in fur? Something that meows. You haven't heard anything meow except for a very big cat. There are no small cats on this island. All sorts of weird things in cages and stuff.
Huh. I compliment him on his efficient use of space.
Oh, thank you. We really do need to move into a larger establishment once our current round of experiments is at an end. You've been injured.
Mm-hmm.
How is it that you've been hurt?
Stumbling around at night.
Oh, that is awful. It does get so terribly dark.
Oh, and I hope no one was injured during that disturbance last night. I understand. After, right around the time you went to go see Scarlet.
Yes, I was so disappointed to find her not at her manor.
Oh?
I ended up having to speak to her in one of the nobles' tents. And it's so difficult to properly raise your voice in frustration when you know that people are trying to sleep nearby.
Did you plead for the fate of the Greenbark gang?
And she was not interested in hearing anything about it. Isn't that terrible.
Hmm.
I understand that you... Do you have an interest in the Greenbark gang? You travel with one.
Oh, right. She is quite unhappy about the situation.
She must be. He, gives you two uses of bandages and just hands them to you because this is nothing to him.
Bandage times two? Awesome, thank you.
Yep.
Might come in handy if, my Greenbark friend decides to get herself hurt.
Yes, indeed. Do tell me. What do you intend to do?
Well, the way I see it, if we can make Scarlet embarrass herself enough, Nyland will have to take action. I suspect that my friend will try a more direct approach to freeing her family. What do you intend to do?
We are not, how you would say, people of action. My brothers and I. We've grown fat on the luxuries afforded our position. But you are an adventurer. And your friends, your outsider friends, they're adventurers too. I was going to find some outsider friends and have them cause some trouble for me. Tell me, you said that if she, Scarlet, were to cause a disappointment or something to that effect, that she might fall from the Baron's protection?
Right, if any of the precious things entrusted to her happen to be lost or damaged enough, well then, her contract with the...
How concerned are you if one of them is lost?
One of who?
One of her precious things. If it were to get loose, how much would that concern you? I understand that it burdens some to worry about consequences.
Let me be clear. I'll mourn for anyone who gets injured in an escape attempt, and I'll be on the front line fighting whatever busts out of there and starts hurting people. Accidents happen.
Give me a roll plus cha. Actually, tell me this. What do you want from Brother Venamo? You could ask for quite a lot of things to assist in this endeavor, and you can be pretty general.
Right. Initially, I was wondering if he was going to make a move. He's not going to make a move because he's not a PC. But if he was going to oppose anything or if any of his interests would be hurt by any of this. But if he can do something to that would give plausible deniability to, say, killing something from the menagerie, like something from the menagerie escapes, oh, and we have to go and fight it and kill it, then that would, because it's running loose and causing a ruckus, that seems like something that he would be within his power to do, and also leave us blameless, and would embarrass Scarlet.
Yep. Okay, give me a roll plus chop.
My whopping plus one charisma. Oh, hey, 11.
Oh, hey. You get a little something extra, if yeah. I remember right. Okay, so he takes you up into the second floor. So it's now, like, perfectly dark. There are no windows up there. And he actually pulls out a little jar that seems to be full of bugs. And he shakes it, and they glow with this amber light. You've heard of amber torch flies? They're something from the desert to the southwest, but they're not native up here. So he takes this little jar and he sets it on a table. And he takes out two red stones and sets them on a table. He touches them with his bare hands, so they're safe to touch. And then he pulls out a little metal vial. And he says, I'm going to show you something very important about Scarlet's little trick. And she doesn't know about this. And it's by far her greatest weakness. You'll want to cover your face. He grabs like a scarf and wraps it over his face.
I grab a scarf and wrap it over my face.
He puts on gloves. And he uncorks the vial. And it's got this like ink black liquid in it. And he pours one little drop onto one of the red stones. And it turns purple. And he puts the cork back in the vial, puts the vial back in his pocket, and he takes a step back. And he's got one of his hands, he's counting. And he's counted up to five, and then he starts counting back till he's got a closed fist. And then the second stone turns purple, the one that wasn't touched by the ink. And then he counts up to five again, and the moment it hits five, both of them shatter.
Oh.
It's communicable, you see. And once it's touched a whole system, that whole system breaks.
Fascinating.
I give you this one dose. He hands you that vial. One drop of it, just one pour, onto a redstone, and this'll happen. The bigger the network, the bigger the bang. Something's gonna get to loose.
Looks that way, brother.
Holy shit.
That's awesome.
He also tells you a little something, and you thus gain a lore.
Nice.
Well, do we want to do our end-of-session stuff?
It seems like a good place to stop.
Yep, that's where I want us to stop. Let's do the end-of-session stuff.
Holy shit.
Let me go to the end of session. When you reach the end of a session, choose one of your bonds that you feel is resolved. So first, Kaya, have you, those bonds that you expressed at the beginning of the game, have any of them changed or been resolved?
I do not feel that any of them have, actually.
That's fine. Impediment, have you resolved any of your bonds?
I think my bonds are good, actually. Isold continues to be deceptively a badass, and Kaya does know how to talk better than I do. / knows restraint. I certainly don't.
Isold, have any of your bonds changed?
I don't think so. I think...
That's a fine thing. Next, Kaya, what is your alignment statement?
Help an animal or spirit of the wild. I had certainly hoped that I might get a chance to do that, but I don't think I did this time around.
I think the jailbreak will provide you opportunity to do that.
Yes, this is the plan.
Impediment. What is your alignment statement?
To eschew a convention of the civilized world.
And how did you eschew convention today?
Well, I mean, I broke and entered, and I totally forgot what money was.
Congratulations, Mark XP.
Yay.
Professor Isold, what is your alignment statement?
I believe it's a discovery of a magical secret about the world, which I certainly did.
Oh,
which you certainly did.
Redstone's interesting.
Discover something about a magical mystery. Yes, yes, sir, I did that.
And then, as a collective, did you learn something new and important about the world?
Yes.
Yeah, I think so.
Is the redstone thing new and important about the world? Because that's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
You don't know exactly how it works, because it seems to control some and repel others, but definitely is something to look into more. So you get that, Mark XP. Did we overcome a notable monster or enemy?
Not really.
Fled one, but not so much overcome.
Yeah, I think you ran away from the horrible red sap spiders.
Truth.
And did we loot a memorable treasure?
I tried to, guys. I tried.
So close.
You did, and then we just destroyed two more of them. But yeah, I think you lost that chance. We traded that.
Yeah.
Conversely, have you decided on when to free the gang?
I don't think we've come to a consensus yet. I think we maybe have some separate ideas about it.
I agree to that. That seems reasonable. So you will have the same goals and the same clocks when we start at the next session. I do actually want to leave Isold with a little something.
Thanks.
Isold, as these arcane secrets are being passed to you in this dark room lit by just the amber glow of the amber torch flies, you notice something at the back of this attic. It's a contraption. It looks like a weird chair covered with copper tubing all around and little bladders. Brother Venamo notices you noticing it, but he doesn't say anything. What do you do?
I can't resist asking, oh, what's that?
Oh, Isolde.
I love her curiosity.
That's the best.
Oh, that is my latest experiment, and it has been so terribly successful. I would like you to do me a favor, if you can. When this all shakes down, and Scarlet is embarrassed, quite possibly embarrassed to death, I would give most anything if I could have one last visit from a green bark to visit my happy little chair.
Oh, you creepy motherfucker.
Thank you, Professor.
I'll see what I can do.
Thank you once again for listening to The Crooked Thimble as we play Iron Immortals. This week's podcast came a little late and will be late next week as well. We've had to move our usual recording time to a little later in the week. We'll be back to normal sometime soon. 7 Days a Servant is available on Inkshares, and we need your help to get the word out. Tell people, in person, on the phone, or by email. Share the site, share the story. We're running out of time to make this work. Our music this week was composed by Sergei Tremzinov. You may find his work in the show notes. Please do share this podcast with whatever means you have available, and remember that the Crooked Thimble is a Patreon-funded company. If you want to hear more of these adventures, please head on over to patreon.com/crookedthimble and support us. And, as always, thank you.